Hey everyone, it's Brandon with FastDataScience.ai, and here is our second edition of This Week in AI. So welcome. Today is January 14th, 2022, and let's just go ahead and jump in and get after it. So remember our little bot, G-Scrapy. What did G-Scrapy deliver for us as some of the top headlines this week? Basically, it was all around market growth. And I love whenever we see new year, lots of new predictions. Everybody has an opinion about the direction that different markets are going. And so here are some of the top markets that are seeing press and movement in the AI space. All right, the number one top headline that came to me first from my little bot for scraping what happened this week in AI, global mobile artificial intelligence market for 2021 on to 2026. So the next 5 years are going to be experiencing some significant growth. Technology, node, product, application, and geography are all areas related, but let's go ahead and break this down and see what the top headlines were in this article on areas of growth for the mobile market. So if you think about it, mobile technology is ubiquitous, it's everywhere. Everybody seems to have a phone these days. And so it only makes sense that artificial intelligence and a lot of its benefits should start to move closer to those devices. And so where do we see growth in mobile AI? We see it in edge computing, all the advances that are happening that are helping to bring AI out of the cloud and closer to whether it be your phone or some other IoT device. But a lot of emphasis going into those phones because everybody has a phone. In addition, that means that we need faster processors, smaller, faster processors that can sit in our phone chips and process artificial intelligence data and models to be able to make those mobile devices even smarter than they already are, reducing latency so those mobile phones no longer have to call cloud services in order to be able to provide you the kinds of intelligence that we've really become accustomed to with those little devices. I mean, if you think about it, 15 years ago, those devices were large, clunky, didn't have near the capability that they have today. Today, a phone no bigger than, say, a calculator has more processing power than really any personal computer ever did 15 years ago, 20 years ago. So processors are gonna be a big area of growth for this space. Look for a lot of the chip companies to be coming out with even more and more sophisticated and advanced processors that enable us to bring those artificial intelligence solutions closer to the hardware that they're actually affecting. The demand in this market is expected to go from 7.2 billion last year in 2021 to grow up to 2026 by over 25% to $22.08 billion. So if you're looking for a space to start getting into, this is a really good area for a lot of young data scientists looking to break into an artificial intelligence field. There are even Python applications available today now that allow you to run Python interpreters on your mobile device. So take a look at what those are. I know Android has one. I've got one on my phone. There's also quite a few others, I believe, and there may even be some for iOS, although I'm not in that space so much. I have talked to my wife and see if she's downloaded any Python interpreter on her phone to do some coding. All right, let's get at it. The next area of growth that we see, machine learning in education for 2022. Industrial IT put together a market analysis looking at the future growth and some of the key players in the education market for machine learning and artificial intelligence. Obviously, the big players, IBM, Microsoft, Google, and Amazon are all extremely interested in this space. What do we see going on in the education market in terms of more specific areas of AI application? All right, here it is, out of the way. Education market is seeing intelligent tutoring systems, so getting smarter at helping students in a more automated fashion by using artificial intelligence. I mentioned last week, GPT-3, one of the largest language models to become generally available to developers and data scientists alike. That does a lot Also, for the education market, you can ask GPT-3 questions, and GPT-3 provides intelligent and fairly accurate, in fact, most of the time, very accurate responses, so it becomes a really nice platform for developing intelligent tutoring systems. Look to see even more of that in the coming year and maybe in the coming multiple years as well. In addition, virtual facilitators, very similar to tutoring systems. However, these are more like augmented systems where you're helping people like me who may be educating folks out there who are interested in learning things like data science and using AI to help facilitate. In fact, you could even argue that me using this little bot to tee up headlines for me in the AI space is a type of virtual facilitator. So look to see a lot more augmentation in the education space using artificial intelligence and machine learning. Content delivery systems, so thinking about getting smarter at delivering the best content that's most relevant for you at the time that you're ready for it. I see Coursera doing this a lot. If you've signed up for Coursera and you've taken a couple of courses, they do a really good job to try and get even more information from you. They probably even track some of your browser cookies to see where you go in order to deliver some recommendations for you on future courses that they have that they think you might enjoy. So look to see a lot more of this kind of thing happening with content delivery systems. I think there's a lot of possibilities for innovation in this space. I'm thinking very deeply about what are things that I might be able to experiment with in order to deliver better, smarter content to you all, for example. Last area in education market that's also seeing some significant growth, interactive websites. So making the browser experience for education even more interactive. There's no question that the application market, I think, is hitting some significant resistance in terms of some of the more browser-based capabilities that are being developed. What do I mean by that? I mean that not everybody wants to download a million different applications for their phone in order to access the resources that those applications provide. So a lot of people are just opting to go back in and visit the website because the browser provides a similar experience and they don't have to download anything, taking up valuable disk space on their mobile device. So look to see a lot more advances in interactive websites, a lot more integration in those websites with artificial intelligence, machine learning, and the tools of data science. All right, jumping on to the next area. So other markets poised for AI growth. We have communications, medical imaging, and maybe just everything. AI is ubiquitous. We know that AI, machine learning, and data science saw significant growth over the last 2 years with hyper-digitalization, especially after the pandemic. A lot of remote folks, a lot of people relying even more today off of digital products and digital services. So what does that mean? That means that a lot of markets are poised for growth. But some of those top markets that my bot teed up for me this week include education, communication, and medical imaging. And I think communication really gets at all of these significant advances that we're seeing in NLP and these very large language models that are being developed to help support more advances and more sophisticated interactions between humans and automated AI systems for communication. Okay, so what this week caught my eye? Okay, let's talk a little bit about, again, it's a who. Basically, this week, this article caught my eye, and I'm gonna explain exactly what I found really, really interesting about this for this week in AI. All right, group of university students in India develop AI models to finally detect fake news. Certainly, they're not the first to attempt this. They're also not the only to be reported on some of the successes that they've had in being able to detect fake news. What I love about this article, again, all these links for articles will be in not the descriptions, because I learned that YouTube doesn't allow me to have certain characters in my video descriptions. So instead, look at the first comment. I'll provide all the links for these articles for you to go check out in more detail if you like. But what I like most about this article is it does a really good job of breaking down from a conceptual point of view how these students approach their problem. And this is what really, really drew my attention this week, is their approach to this problem for me is inspiring in thinking about how I approach my own data science problems and data science solutions to those problems. So these former students developed a model for fake news prediction. There they are, our aspiring entrepreneurs in data science, machine learning, and artificial intelligence. What's really cool about this solution to be able to detect fake news is that they combine multiple different techniques into a system or an architecture that provides them with pretty accurate predictions on whether or not a particular news article might be fake news. So I'm gonna break it down for you real quick here, but again, I encourage you to go check out the article, and hopefully you'll get inspired to think about your own data science problems in a more sophisticated way, which is architectures. Architectures that combine lots of different data science techniques can be used and leveraged if put together properly. Think of it like Legos, right? If we're building a building or a car or whatever with Legos, we need those pieces to come together all in the right way so that we can produce something that looks as close to the real thing as possible. Artificial intelligence and data science work really similarly. So in this case, what these students did, let's call them entrepreneurs because that's exactly what they are. What they did was they experimented with multiple different ways of putting together different data science solutions so that they could produce a prediction that was as accurate as it could possibly be. I'm showing you a graph here. This graph is probably a little much as you're watching this video, so let's break it down in a much higher level and take a look at exactly what their process looked like. So step one, text pre-processing. Everybody who deals with natural language processing data totally understands that that data need to be pre-processed. We need to get rid of noise. The goal is to get to the text that is the core of the information that you're trying to classify. So we need to do lots of pre-processing, removing stop words, removing, in this case, they're pulling text off the internet, which is even messier than most sources of text because it has embedded HTML or it has other funky emojis or weird characters. So we got to be able to clean all that out, hyperlinks, things like that that may not be all that important for predicting whether or not a particular article is fake news. Next step is to then tokenize that cleaned text, create information that can be processed eventually into numbers. So we tokenize things, which basically just means split out your meaningful chunks of information. We might split those tokens into sentences, or we'll split those tokens further into words or character strings, or maybe even further into sub-character strings within those words that we may find. So tokenization in and of itself can be a fairly sophisticated approach to cleaning and pre-processing text data. Then they layered in pre-trained language models. Really, really cool area of data science for the more advanced data science scientists to look into is transfer learning. There are a large number of open source, freely available, pre-trained models that were trained on very large data sets. And this is true especially for natural language processing and language models, but also for computer vision and vision models. One of the nice things about the open sourcing of those models is that we as developers can get access to the model. We can essentially cut the last layer off, which is making the prediction for those models, and we can train those models, or fine-tune them is what it's called, to be able to make new predictions. So we get the benefit of all of that training in that model architecture that happened on a corpus of, say, a billion documents in the case of NLP. And then we can use just the last layer to train it for our specific problem. So that's what these researchers did. They actually used multiple pre-trained models. They fine-tuned them for their use case to create kind of that first layer prediction. They ensembled those together to create different feature vectors. They also then performed additional feature engineering using some statistical techniques whereby they can look at features such as maybe the source of an article, which might be predictive of whether or not that article is fake news. So they can use the likelihood that a particular source is in and of itself a source of fake news to be able to develop predictions. They fuse all of those features that they create both from the models as well as from their more kind of statistical heuristic approach to looking at features. They put all those together and then they produce a sort of outcome or output model that then allows them to take advantage of all that information and make a prediction so that they can get as accurate as possible in this heuristic post-processing to be able to say this article is either fake news or it's not. I look to see a lot more things like this coming out from Facebook and others. I love that a group of ex-students or former students were able to put this together. The article does a really great job. It's really inspiring. It does a great job of explaining what they've done. And hopefully for you, it gives you some really good ideas on thinking about data science problems not as single model problems, but rather as a pipeline, an ensemble of lots of different models that you can combine and lots of different techniques that we learn as we sort of, you know, progress through our data science journey that we can then apply to be able to solve really complex problems like this that are really challenging. So that's it for me for this week on This Week in AI. I hope you guys enjoyed the headlines that I shared with you today. Please feel free to comment, add feedback, let me know what you like, what you don't like. I certainly hope to be doing more of these. And so the more interaction I get from you, the better I can make them. Apologize for my very unsavvy video editing skills. But hopefully, again, you guys get some value out of the things that I'm sharing. I hope you all have a great weekend. If you're watching this and it's not a Friday, because maybe you don't get this till Monday or Tuesday, I'm sorry. But hey, there's another Friday in your future. So I hope you tune in next week on This Week in AI. I'll have more headlines to share with you and my breakdown of them. Thank you very much. And have a great weekend, everybody.